Ukraine.
In Ramallah, in refugee camps. That was, you know, the biggest experience I had. But apart from that, when we joined into in a large project which was being run by the Ministry of Social Welfare, that gave us an opportunity of identifying how we can work with refugees from a different perspective, because up to those years the European Commission was basically pumping in millions of euros to give to NGOs to assist the immigrants, but unfortunately many of the NGOs were just seeing it as a money-making initiative. Because as I mentioned yesterday, for example, when I visited the first time the site, I realized that they had huge boxes and packets of pasta and ham, which the refugees, they had not even seen before, because they never had pasta. So that was all waste of money and waste of food. And the refugees were not happy. We also realized that the way they were teaching them on integration, like teaching them English and teaching them Maltese, the way it was being done was, as Lillian mentioned, everything by the book. But these people, you don't know their level, their basic level of education. So if you don't understand their basic level of education, how can you teach them
anything?
So what we did was we said, okay, we are going to go a bit radical. In fact, when we submitted our application, it was a European Social Fund. Basically, I was called by the ministry to explain what this crazy idea was about. Because they always had applications where people were NGOs, were asking for millions, employing 20 workers, they want a new office, they want new nice equipment, new nice chairs. In fact, I went to an NGO and I was really shocked, because, you know, I work in the consultancy industry with businessmen, and when I entered into this NGO, I find a state of the art office. And I told them, wow, you have benefactors. They told me, oh, we got it from the, you know, European funding. And I was really shocked. Because basically, what we wanted to do was we wanted to work with volunteers. Nobody is being paid, just being given a small amount of money to cover their transport costs.
Really crazy idea.
It was a really crazy idea, and we had a lot of other NGOs who were very angry at us because we broke their status quo.
Yes.
Because, you know, it was a monopoly of five NGOs who were getting millions. They just, you know, provide the two-hour training in English. They don't care if they will learn English or not, so long as the teacher is being paid extra of what she earns normally. And we were providing everything for free. And basically then what we did with regards to the teaching was using role plays and using media. We are lucky that we have a very large, vast network of volunteers who are professionally working in different areas, like psychologists, like drama teachers, for example, the government drama school, basically starting from the head teacher and going down to all their teachers. They have one day or another all supported us in various projects by giving their free time to teach just basic activities. And also you are giving these young refugees the opportunity to meet with people, because, you know, when I get actors who are semi-professional actors, and you tell this guy who is lost in Malta, knows nobody, he's just a no one, just a number, a refugee number, and you tell him, listen, this guy who is going to teach you today, he produces a film, and, you know, we show them on YouTube the films, and they feel sort of important,
of course,
because they are meeting with important people, like you mentioned with Guterres, and that gives an opportunity, because we believe if we want to enter and do something good, we have to measure how crazy our ideas are, but also try to be innovative. When I get interns in our office, the first thing I tell them is, listen, you came here, you applied, I didn't ask you, you applied to come. You decided to come 3 months or 6 months, no, these are the rules. If you don't want to deliver the work, just there's the door open, just leave and enjoy 3 months holiday. I don't care. But after 3 months, I'm not going to sign any papers, so you will be in trouble. Time, I don't care about time. If you want to come at 11 o'clock to work, you come at 11. You have the task, I know how long the task gives you, you have to do it. So we leave them very, very flexible.
Yeah,
and when we had these refugees coming to the office to do some to learn administration work, at first they are shocked.
Of course.
So what time actually we start? I am here at 9, you can come at 9, you can come at 8. You can come at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Mm. You have your task, I need that task. On Friday there are no excuses. You can work on the beach. You don't need to come to the office. But if you come to the office, I will mentor you. And that flexibility, after giving them this shock, they understand it. And even when they are writing, you know, summaries, I tell them I don't want copy-paste from Google, but I want innovation and creativity. And the more crazy you are with your ideas, the better it is. To give you a small example, once I used to work with the European Commission, and I was tasked to do training to very, very, very top officials. You know, they all came with nice suits, with ties, with secretaries, with their bodyguards. And I told them, okay, bodyguards, secretaries, out. Mobiles, tablets, off. Remove your bloody tie and your shirt. And the British commissioner, he came to me, he told me, sorry, you know who these people are? I told him, yes. He told me, some are commissioners, some are director generals, so you don't tell them like this. I told him, listen, your commission, European Commission, is paying me thousands for this half a day session. So, because these people are up there in the clouds, where there's a storm underneath, so they don't even see what's under the clouds, because they have lost contact completely with the population. Because everybody tells you, yes, yes, you are sure. Nobody says the contrary. And so I managed to convince this British guy, who was really diplomatic, that yes, he has to obey me. If not, it's not a problem. I leave, I receive my check, and say goodbye. And I told him, okay, so now, stand around, I place, and I made them play the chairs games. You know, when you have the chair, you have the music. When the music stops,
like little children.
Because I wanted them to understand from where they went out. And it was very shocking. And after, when we finished the day session, we went to a restaurant, high restaurant, where I made it clear to the manager that he has to sign me a document which we will sue him and any staff who takes a picture with millions. If anybody takes a picture, we will sue them and close the establishment. And they all signed. And I made sure that all the waiters, nobody had a mobile. Because then
they were
enjoying and dancing. And these people were people who, if you're walking up the stairs, you just stop. You don't continue walking because they are gods. But that small session gave them back the reality of what is a human being. And that is the way we work in our association with immigrants and socially deprived people.